Sometimes you might be asking yourself, when are these derivatives going to be useful for anything anyway? Well, today, we're going to talk about one specific application for derivatives, and that is critical points. What does it mean to be a critical point? A critical point on a function is a point at which the derivative is either zero or undefined. That means that critical points occur wherever the slope of the graph is completely flat, which doesn't happen for every function. Knowing where these points are can help you answer questions about the function like, what's the function's maximum or what's the function's minimum? Notice that in order to find the critical point for a function, there actually has to be a point on the graph where the derivative is equal to zero. And there are plenty of functions that don't have any critical points at all, simply because the values of those functions' derivatives are never zero, like linear equations or exponential decaying growth functions. Before we get even further into discussing critical points, let's take a look at what it means for a point to be a function's maximum or minimum. When we look at the graph of a function, we can see that the curve doesn't get any higher than this point for the entire interval of the function we're looking at. That is, the coordinates for this point contain the highest y value of the function, so we would call that the function's maximum. Now, it's important to know that maxima and minima come in two different types, local and global. A global maximum or global minimum is one like this example we just looked at, meaning that it's the maximum or minimum for the entire function, everywhere on the function's domain. A local maximum or minimum, on the other hand, applies only to a specific interval of the function, or you could think of it as a specific region or neighborhood of the function. On this graph, for example, we have several local minimums and maximums, but only one global minimum. This is the global minimum because it's the lowest value the function ever attains, and this is a local minimum because it's the lowest value this function attains in this particular area of the graph. So what's the relationship between critical points and these maximum and minimum points that we've been looking at? Well, you may have noticed that at both local and global maximum and minimum points, the slope of the curve was flat. So each of these extrema points, these max and min points, are actually critical points. However, it's important to remember that even though all extrema points are critical points, not all critical points are extrema. As an example, there's a point on this graph where the derivative is equal to zero, but that point clearly isn't a maximum or minimum for the function. Now that we've gone a little bit into why finding critical points can be helpful to us, let's talk about how we can actually find those critical points. The first way is the way we've been identifying critical points so far. If we have the graph of the function, if we have a picture of it, in order to find critical points, we just need to ask ourselves, where is the derivative equal to zero or non-existent? On the graph, anywhere that the derivative equals zero will look like a horizontal tangent line, and anywhere the derivative doesn't exist will look like this, which we call a corner. Let's imagine for a second that we don't have a graphing calculator, and we're pet-sitting for our neighbor's dog, and instead of telling us how much to feed the dog, our nerdy neighbor just left us with this function, which gives us the number of kibble bits to feed the dog depending on the current distance from the moon. We have no idea how to measure the current distance from the moon, so we just decide to find the minimum amount of food her dog needs. That way, we don't overfeed the dog, but we also keep it alive. Well, we know that the minimum of the function will be a critical point. And we know that we find critical points anywhere where the derivative is either zero or does not exist. So let's take the derivative of the function that our neighbor gave us. We use power rule to find the derivative of the polynomial function, and we get that the derivative is equal to 4x plus 3. The first thing we ask ourselves now is this derivative ever undefined? In this case, the derivative is always defined because the derivative itself is a polynomial function. So then we move on to ask ourselves, when will this derivative be equal to zero? We set the derivative equal to zero, and then with a little bit of algebra, we see that this equation is true when x is equal to negative 3/4. But this still doesn't tell us how much food to feed to our neighbor's dog. So we now need to take this x value that we found, this potential critical point, and plug it into the original function to figure out the corresponding y value. Doing that, we get that we need to feed the dog at least 25.875 pieces of kibble, so we'll just go ahead and give him 26 pieces to make sure he has enough. Now, there are a couple things to note about finding critical points this way. The first is that you'll often find more than one critical point for a function. For example, let's say you have a function and you just found that there are critical points at x equals negative 8, negative 5, and positive 14. In this case, determining whether each of these critical points is a maximum or a minimum is going to take a little bit of extra work. You'll need to plug in each one of these x values to get its corresponding y value, and then compare the y values to determine which critical points represent global maximums and minimums, and which ones represent local maximums and minimums. Some of the critical points might even be critical points, but not extrema. One easy way to keep track of all this information is to create a chart like this one. Notice that in addition to the x and y values that we found for our critical points, we also need to look at the behavior of the function for values on either side of each of the critical points. In other words, we need to pick a value in between every critical point so that we can see what the function is doing as it travels from one critical point to the next. So for example, if we were looking at this function's behavior on the interval negative 9 to 15, in other words, the whole interval we have represented here, then we could say that there's a maximum at the point negative 8, 2, because we can see that the function goes down on either side of x equals negative 8. At negative 8, the function's up at 2, but if we head to the left toward negative 9, the function is going down from 2 to 1. Or if we start at negative 8 and we head to the right toward negative 6, the function is going from 2 down to negative 1. So because the function is going down on both sides, the point negative 8, 2 has to represent a maximum. Likewise, the point negative 5, negative 3 is a minimum because the function is going up on either side of negative 5, and the point 14, 1 is another maximum since the function is going down from 1 to negative 1 on the left and from 1 to 0 on the right-hand side of x equals 14. So we had a maximum at negative 8, 2, a minimum at negative 5, negative 3, and another maximum at 14, 1. If we compare the two maximum values, we have negative 8, positive 2, and then 14, positive 1. Since 2 is greater than 1, the global maximum on this interval has to be at negative 8, 2, which means that 14, 1 is just considered a local maximum. So now we know what to do when we need to feed our neighbor's dog, and more importantly, we know how to find local and global extrema using critical points.